Stay tuned for The Joan Quinn Profiles. As an editor for Andy Warhol's Interview, the Los Angeles Herald Examiner, LA Style, and Detour magazines, Joan covered the social set, the Hollywood hotshots, the international art scene, the mysteries of food, the excitement of travel, and the fabulous world of fashion. Joan continues to find creative people on the cutting edge who make things happen. Here's Joan Agajanian Quinn.
Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and welcome to the Joan Quinn Profiles. Waiting to be profiled is architect Frederick Fisher and singer Banig. Fred Fisher graduated from Oberlin College in 1971 with a Bachelor of Arts in Art and Art History. He went on to the UCLA School of Architecture. Fred has lectured throughout the country. His work has been published in architecture magazines, and he has been busy in commercial and residential designs. Which do you prefer, Fred, residential or commercial?
Well, it depends on the moment. Sometimes when you're doing one, you wish you were doing the other. But in general, I am very happy that I have a mixture of things. And one, from one standpoint, that intellectually and creatively, it keeps you on your toes and moving, and different ideas come into different areas. But also in terms of, I didn't think about it ahead of time, but pragmatically it's good, because in some part, sometimes with the economy going one way, one kind of work is stronger than another. So if you're balanced in different kinds of work, it maybe it's a good survival characteristic.
Are the demands different when you're dealing with, say, one person in a residential or two people as compared to a company?
It's very different. It's very different. I mean, that's one of the things that makes it interesting, and why I probably couldn't do all of any one of them. On one hand, working in residential work is very intimate and very often you can explore the ideas in a more depth than you can in a commercial project. But at the same time, that intimacy and that personal quality can make it very demanding and turn you into an informal shrink or counselor, relationship counselor, which is very demanding. And so I think I wouldn't be able to do that all the time.
And do you think that it either makes your relationship better building this house and participating in every aspect of these people's lives, because you're building a mm-hmm. place for them to live?
Yes.
I saw a house that you did in Pittsburgh, mm-hmm. and I noticed that for an architect, I don't know if these demands were different for you as an architect wanting to come in and do your own thing, but the person who was building the house wanted to keep some of the old things, like the fireplaces and mm-hmm. the moldings. Mm-hmm. Did that create a problem with your mentality?
In contrast to creating a problem, it's actually why I got the job in the first place, because there was a house on the property that had been in the woman's family prior to her acquiring the property, and she had very fond memories of that property and wanted to incorporate some of the ruins of the house that was there before and some of the fragments of it. And one of my first houses was a house I designed up in Hollywood based on the theme of ruins. And this was done right after the Hollywood fire. And she had seen that house published, and that was what first brought me to her attention, was the notion of incorporating new ruins into the house. So that's what led to doing the house to begin with. I also liked the notion of collage, and I like mixing new and old, and so I had no problem at all with the mixture.
That was the right team then. Mm-hmm. It worked out together. You've done a lot of work in Japan. You've done work mm-hmm. In California. Are those mentalities different as far as what people want?
Well, they're very different. Partly it's because of the different types of organizations we work with. In Japan, we worked for a large developer, and their building industry is structured very different there. You often have a case where there is a contractor who has their own in-house architecture department, engineering. They get the permits, they supervise the construction, they do everything. And so we just provided a schematic and a developed design input, and then the contractor did everything else. And in one sense, that makes it very easy for us, and they did a beautiful job of the drawings and of construction. But on the other hand, it takes away a bit of control because you don't always know the decisions that are being made and you're not included in every single discussion. And then sometimes when things shift from one language to another, you're not always able to participate in every discussion you want to be in. So it has its advantages and disadvantages. Also, there was an interesting thing about working there is the notion of consensus building.
What does that mean?
Well, there was a room which we went in when we worked with this contractor. We would go for meetings, and there was a sign on the door which said decision room.
Oh.
And basically it meant that you went into that room and a decision would be made, and you would stay there until a decision was made. And there would be about 20 men in blue and gray suits sitting around a table, and each one firing away their questions, and these sessions would last for hours and hours and hours, and you wouldn't leave until everybody had the answers that they wanted. It was a...
Were they making the decision, or were you making the decision?
Both.
Yeah. So nobody came out. Did it have to go a certain way, do you think, or was it...
Well, it's consensus building. There's a little bit of give and take.
Talking about consensus building or giving and taking, you've worked with a lot of artists in artist studio spaces and also gallery spaces.
Right.
Are those demands different, the gallery owner compared to the artist?
I certainly wouldn't say that there's a generic gallery owner or generic artist. They're all different, as you might expect, as you well know, in fact. And one of the aspects of working with artists is that they, I think, are very, with probably some good reason, very wary of architects kind of overwhelming their own work with the architect's expression. And so there's a real level of comfort that has to be achieved, that you're going to respect their ideas, their work, and not overtake it with your own. And with art dealers, they all have a vision about how they want to show art, and that's different. There's quite a range of the way art dealers like to show their art, and each dealer tends to have a variety of artists. So you are showing big things and little things, sculpture, painting. Any one gallery has to function in a lot of different ways. So it's pretty complex, and there is no one answer to any of those situations.
I think just what you're saying, where an artist feels that an architect's going to come in and put his mark on it.
Mm-hmm.
And when we talk about a Fred Fisher mark, what does it mean? What is your imprimatur?
Well, with respect, I'm trying to figure that out right now because I'm in the process of doing a book on my work with Rizzoli, which will be out in about a year. And I'm trying to figure out what it is that I do. And one of the things that comes up in our discussions with artists and curators and doing art spaces is the notion of providing a silent hermetic space.
Ah.
And that has to do with not a lot of visual noise that competes with the art, and not what we call leaky space, so that your attention and the viewer's imagination and thoughts are not sucked out of the space. Looking at art is kind of an artificial activity, and we feel that it has to be done in kind of a hermetic setting.
Did that come up time and time again?
Yeah.
On these buildings?
Well, it's sort of evolved over time. We haven't talked about it that way.
But
I mean, I've been doing studios for a long time, and it's been after a while we heard ourselves kind of saying the same thing and saying, well, this is kind of a concept.
Uh-huh.
Another one would certainly be natural light, and that there's the beauty of our California daylight is famous, and it's one of the reasons why I love working here, and certainly I think art never looks better than when it's in daylight.
So we have two models here, and maybe the things that you were just telling us about can apply, or you can show how they apply to these. Should we start with this one first? You want to tell us about that?
Well, that one has really not much to do with art. It's a Theravada Buddhist monastery.
But it has to do with your mark on architecture.
Okay. client is an American that I went to school with at Oberlin, who went to Thailand to study Thai language and culture and basically never came back. And after 20 years, he rose in the hierarchy and is now the first Westerner to become an abbot within this tradition of Buddhism. And he's the abbot of this monastery, which is located in the Palma Valley of northern San Diego County.
Oh, this is in America?
Yes.
Oh, how great.
It's the community is basically a Thai American community. And so I went to Thailand and traveled all over the country and looked at dozens of monasteries, which was a very interesting way to look at Thailand because it's such a deeply Buddhist country, and tried to bring away elements which would remind the Thais of their own culture, and those include the nested roofs that you see.
Should I lift it?
Okay. The nested roofs that you see in this building. This is called a sala, which is where the monks have meditation and where they ordain the new monks. And the nested roofs is a very traditional aspect of Thai architecture, as is the low eave. And then this is called a chedi, which is like a stupa in India. It's a structure that actually represents the Buddha. This will be a Bodhi tree, which will, of course, you know, we plant it small. Actually, we're going to plant a cluster of small trees, and they'll grow into one very large tree. The Bodhi tree also represents the Buddha. This is a pond of water, and in the notion of feng shui, that Chinese art of locating things, you want to have water to the south and a mountain to the north, and that's actually the setting of this project. This happens to be on a hilltop, and we put an artificial pond of water to the south of the sacred buildings, and then there happens to be a natural hill to the north, so that in terms of feng shui, this is correctly located. Also, the main structures face east, which is traditionally Thai.
Did you have someone come in and choose the area? Decide how it should be or where it should be placed on the hilltop?
I did it with working with the monk, and that I had read a number of books on feng shui and in traveling to Thailand, seeing how they were done there, and just in our discussions about Thai culture and geomancy, that I, you know, we developed it between ourselves. We didn't bring in an expert per se on that.
Now this one, very quickly.
This is the LA Louvre Gallery, which is now under construction in Venice, and it is a rather unique situation where a private art gallery is building what is basically a small museum. The spaces in it, which we're trying to achieve this notion of a hermetic environment for art, include an outdoor gallery, which we're calling a sky room, which takes advantage of the climate and light that we have available here. So it's a room which is exposed, where the roof of the room is the sky, and you can put sculpture in it all year round. The upstairs, which is kind of the business part of the gallery, has a private showing room and a more public gallery. And then the solid area is what we call the background space, is the library, the preparation area, the staff offices. And then the main gallery is on the lower level. And this is the entry area. And then there's a large principal gallery and what we call a jewel box gallery off of that, which is an isolated little gallery that will have, you know, special exhibits.
Our time is running out, but before we leave, I think that the way you've done things is fabulous. But you're doing something in China, which is very exciting because you're one of the first Americans to come in at this time, and it's a produce community or market type of thing. And I just wanted you to show when you go, what you do, how you take. I'll show them.
Okay.
Because this is his notebook. Tell us where from Beijing.
Yes, I mean this is actually a little like a school notebook that I got in Beijing, working with the people there. I'm working with Cordoba Corporation, which is a planning firm, on what will be by far the world's largest produce market. And it's 1,100 acres, about 10 miles from Tiananmen Square. And we're master planning this. And this stage, it involves two residential villages, a large shopping center, millions of square feet of produce transaction area. It will be used by upwards of 200,000 people per day when it's finally completed.
And these are all your little drawings?
Yeah, it's a little bit of everything. I make notes. I got a little sketch there of when we were flying out of Tokyo. I drew Mount Fuji, and there's diagrams in there. There's notes, meeting notes, and you know, there's a little bit of everything. It's just
great.
Kind of, you know, stream of consciousness when I was there.
It's great, and I think when you sit down at the drawing board, you put all these together.
Mm-hmm.
And we were happy you sat down at our drawing board today and showed us all the things that you've done.
My pleasure.
Thanks, Fred. Don't go away. We'll be back with Banig, and we thank Fred Fisher for being with us today. See you in a minute. Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and we're back with singer, songwriter, and musician Banig. By day, Josephine Roberto is an honor student at Van Nuys High School. At night, she transforms herself into Banig, a singer who, when she was living in Manila, played to concert crowds of 500,000 people and starred on television. She started her career at the age of 8 and wowed the judges on Star Search. She went on to appear on the Arsenio Hall Show, Rick Dees, Maury Povich, Steve Edwards, and today the Joan Quinn Profiles has Banig. Why'd you leave Manila?
Well, we wanted to pursue a singing career here in the United States, and we wanted to try out for the mainstream, you know, because we barely have Filipinas who make it here in America, so we wanted to try here.
Well, how did you classify yourself when you talk about being mainstream in America? Were you mainstream in Manila?
Well, in Manila, I was a singer. I started out when I was 8 years old singing in talent shows, and I won, and they gave me the name and everything, and I started doing concerts, and you know, basically being a singer, a known singer in the Philippines. But when I started doing Star Search in Arsenio Hall, a lot of people here liked it, so I, you know, we kind of said, no, let's not, why don't we try here in America, because we barely have Filipinas that make it here, too.
Did you speak English at that time, or just Tagalog?
Well, in the Philippines, we have a English subject, and everyone in the Philippines know how to speak English, but I wasn't comfortable speaking or carrying a conversation with anybody. I always said, you know, I'm a Filipina, I must speak Tagalog, or I'm going to be disloyal to the language or something. But trying it here in the United States, you have to speak English or nobody would know you.
Do you still speak your native tongue?
Oh, yes. my parents don't, you know, really like it if I, you know, whenever I'm speaking English at home, because I learn it automatically in school and outside school on the phone with my friends, but they don't want me to lose the language.
And I don't want you to lose it either. I think it's a shame when people lose the language. Now, getting back, I know Banig means something in your native language.
Right.
How did you get the name, and tell us what it means?
Well, when I was doing that talent show in the Philippines, I was the youngest finalist. I was the youngest champion, the tiniest, with a big voice. So the MC teased me about it, and they said, you know, why are you joining this talent show when you're too small, you're probably still wetting your bed, your mattress, and mattress is Banig.
That's what I heard. That's what I heard. I knew it was something that you put on the floor that you can sleep on like a mat.
Right.
And I wondered, how did she ever get this name? I wanted to know.
In the Philippines, when you hear Banig, that's something, Banig. But in America, nobody would know unless you tell them the whole story.
I was doing my research, and when I found out what it was, I went, how did she get that? Does that mean people are going to be stepping on her?
Yeah. And everyone who saw the show, the contest, knew me as Banig, as this little girl who's still with her bed. And that's what everybody called me, and it just got stuck. It's unique, but I don't plan on changing it as I grow older.
You talk about having a big voice. You've been compared to Mariah Carey and Whitney Houston. Are those people your idols? Or
Yes, they are, yeah.
Who do you think influences you, or who does influence you?
My idols, Whitney, Aretha, Tina Turner, and my parents, I guess, because they've, you know, worked so hard on, you know, this music thing.
Are they musical?
Yes, they are.
What do they do?
Well, my mom was a music teacher, and my dad's just basically the music-minded in the house. So ever since I was little, he used to give me all these tapes of my favorite singers, and I used to listen to them and try to imitate them.
So you had Aretha tapes in Manila?
Yeah, back then, I couldn't even understand what they were saying, but I just imitated and just started mimicking the sound, even though I didn't know how to speak English back then. And I started out singing Tagalog songs, but now I'm singing all of them, you know.
Tagalog. Tagalog. Tagalog.
Right.
Tagalog. But we're going to see you sing, because you brought a video for us. And then we can talk about your style and what a big voice this little girl has. What's the song we're going to sing?
It's called I Talk. I Talk.
And I think it's, we have the CD and the
right.
poster
the
behind
poster
you.
Uh-huh. Right here, and that's the CD.
And here's the CD. So let's see that right now. Obviously, it's a big part of your show.
Right.
Do you dance?
Yes, I do dance. I dance in school. I choreograph with my sister and everything.
Do you do all the moves on that video?
Yeah, most of them. Well, I don't know. Sometimes when I perform on stage, some move just comes out, and when I look back, I can never do it again or something.
Well, nobody can tell. You are so short. How tall are you?
I don't know. Probably 5'11"
No,
something
you're not
like
5
that.
Feet. Under 5 feet.
Yeah.
Do you pick people to be on stage with you who are short too, so you look big?
Yeah. Well, I'm not that short, but yeah. Well,
Do you have? Can you choose who's on with you?
It doesn't really matter to me if they're tall or not. Just as long as they're not, 6 feet tall and everything, because then I'd look real small, real small.
Yeah, this way you have the strength. Now, this is a Delphi record.
Yes,
and Delphi record was founded by Bob Keane,
right,
who was a guest on our show at one time, and he discovered Ritchie Valens.
Mm-hmm.
Now, do you think you're going to be the young discovery, the Filipina discovery?
Jeez, I hope.
I hope.
I hope.
How did Bob find you?
Well, we met through a friend, through one of his artists, Tony Bazzurto and Kevin Costner. Yeah. And we just met and we showed him the tape and he liked it, so right then we started doing the album and everything. We did the album pretty quick too. So
it was one of those things where he hadn't been working for a long time, but when he saw you, he said it was just like, this is the new thing. This is the greatest thing I've seen for a long time. Now you have something to live up to.
Right.
Do you still take voice lessons?
Well, I do it at home.
Did you ever take voice lessons?
Oh, yes, I did. I took voice lessons when I was 7 years old, and then I stopped, and then I took it again for like 1 month, and then I stopped. But I do it at home.
And you do play an instrument.
Yeah, I play the saxophone.
You what?
I play the saxophone.
Isn't it bigger than you?
No, I just play the little one, the alto sax.
Oh,
but I don't think I'll be able to carry the tenor sax or the baritone, so it's...
They're too big.
Yeah, they're too big.
And do you write music as well?
Yeah, I write songs and everything. And I try to collaborate with other writers who are more experienced than I am, because... you want to be safe. And we didn't use one of the songs, one of the songs that I wrote in the first album, probably the next one, but,
Do you look to have a show that'll be all your own songs at one point in your career?
Yeah. Yeah, probably, when I get big or something, I'd be able to do a lot of more of my stuff, because now whenever I do shows, I do a lot of songs from other artists. But probably one day I'll get to do those.
Do original music.
Yeah, do original
music. Do you still travel and do concert tours?
Yes, yes. I love doing concerts. It's like, it's, I think that I'm more comfortable doing concerts than studio work. Because when you're in the studio, you stay there for hours and just trying to do one song. But while you're in the audience, when you're doing a live concert, you're communicating with the audience and everyone's having a good time. But I don't like performing in front of, you know, adult crowd.
Is that so right? You can tell when you're on stage,
yeah,
if you have an adult crowd or a young crowd?
Yeah. Dull crowd.
Oh, dull.
Adult,
oh, I thought
crowd.
You meant adult. Oh,
adult
dull. Yeah, you,
yeah,
like the interaction?
Yeah, because I don't know, when they're not having fun, I'm not having fun, so I'd like for them to have fun with me. So as far as ages, I like performing in front of all ages, you know, as much as I can. And I don't want to get just the teenagers. I don't want to get just the adults, because my music is not just for a certain, you know, age. So I like performing in front of everybody.
Well, we're all going to watch you. And before, we're going to grow up with you, because I think you have a lot of growing up. You have to get older. And when you get older, do you ever think that you'll give up your career and have a family and a marriage? Or have you ever thought about that far?
Oh, right now, I'm so into the music that I don't know. I don't know if I'm going to get married either. But I know that there's music is going to be always here with me, in me. And I can't imagine my life without it. So.
We can't either. After seeing you perform, we thank you, Banig, for being with us. And we thank you for watching the Joan Quinn Profiles today.
Right.
Come back again next time, and I'll hold this up for you. You want me to hold this up?
Yes.
Keep writing to us at 520 South Grand.
It's called Banig. Can You Feel My Heart?
Banig.
Can You Feel My Heart? That's the album title.